bomb, I think.
Well, lovely talking to you, and congratulations on making this second installment as riveting as the first one.
Oh, thank you very much.
Now that you've done it, you do realize that there was, you know, more pathos to those characters. There was more to the story than you originally intended, right?
I didn't think that there would be ever a story I could tell that was more personal than that first movie, because as bizarre as it sounds, it was a love letter to my kids. And the idea of parenting and what would you really do for your kids. But the one idea that kept popping into my head was, what if you made Millie the lead character of the story? She's the key to continuing the metaphors and the themes that we were talking about in the first movie, which is family and sort of the idea of parents and children, but even more so the idea of youth and the idea of youth being more bold and more courageous than the generation before them. And so that really opened everything up for me, is once I had Millie in mind, I knew I could do something with it.
You know, I asked Emily the same question when I interviewed her a couple of weeks ago. You know, is it a very silent set? Is it really a set that echoes the atmosphere, the eeriness of the story?
I wish I could say yes, because it would be a cooler answer, but the truth is they're all goofballs. I was surrounded by a team of goofballs. My wife, I think, being Queen Goofball. In Quiet Place 1, when she did that bathtub scene, that was only one take. And after, I remember she was screaming, looking up, screaming, and then when I called cut, she genuinely switched and said, by the way, what's for lunch? I heard it was fajitas. Is it fajitas? So when you have actors that are that good that they can turn it on and turn it off, it allows for, to be honest, a much more exciting set.
There are people out there. People worth saving.
You felt that this installment was a little bit more informed by the feedback of the fans because it was such a success the first time?
Absolutely. And I think, to be really honest with you, I only did the movie at the end of the day because I thought, if I have to make a organic and deserving sequel because of the generous response we got on the first movie. I was thinking about the audience every single step of the way while writing the script, because I didn't want it to feel like a sequel for sequel's sake. It was really about how amazing the response was in the first movie and how genuine people fell in love with his characters, that I wanted to continue that and continue that story.
Most people had finally given up hope.
Obviously, it was wrapped before the pandemic started, but now it's not kind of it's accompanying, you know, the end of the pandemic and the return to cinema. So how do you feel about that? And how happy are you that we kind of waited?
Because we were the last movie to be pulled before everything sort of normalcy went out the window, I wanted to be the person that brought normalcy back with you. So I wanted to be the first movie out so that I could sort of greet you the same, with the same drama that we went out.
I don't know why you came all the way up here.
There's nothing left.
Please. The final question is about acting and directing. Obviously, you're in this one much less than in the first one, and it's hard enough to direct alone or act alone. Do you feel more comfortable when it's less of one and more of the other, or you kind of have it?
Being an actor, when you're directing, is so exciting because you don't have to cut. You can kind of keep the magic alive in a scene, and you actually are a part of the scene with people, so you can give subtle notes and keep rolling, and it actually feels more like a play than it does a movie set. It's just a play that happens to have cameras catching whatever we can.